Web3 can have a huge impact, not just on crypto or tech or even finance, but on the entire world. Yes, it's early days, but we do think Web3 looks pretty awesome. And we're not alone. Web3 has welcomed waves of venture capitalists who have been pouring money into Web3 protocols and generating masses of hype. So if you're wondering what Web3 is and how it could disrupt the world, then keep watching. I'm Jessica, and here at CoinMarketCap, we love making videos about all things crypto, from crypto news to market moves and even educational videos like the one you're watching today. So if you do want something more than just hype and to actually learn about crypto, make sure to subscribe and turn on the notifications to not miss any more videos like this. According to the market data and analyst company Pitchbook, venture capitalists have been pumping $27 billion into crypto platforms and crypto-related projects so far in 2021. Yahya, a crypto partner at the venture capital firm Andreessen Horowitz, recently said that we are at an inflection point that will lead to even a faster pace of innovation and growth in Web3. Even the mainstream media, including The Guardian and The New York Times, they've picked up on the hype and are writing about, you've guessed it, Web3. Ideas for Web3 were actually first pitched all the way back in 1999 by none other than the inventor of the World Wide Web himself, Tim Berners-Lee. Berners-Lee actually believed that what we're seeing today and what we're experiencing, referencing to Web3, would be known as something called semantic web, which would involve AI solving problems like unclear search queries and using linguistic context. I'm going to give you an example. When evaluating a question or a search query like, what is a Jaguar? This could refer to the cat or the car by using the context of the question. But what Web3 has actually turned out to be or might look like is so much more exciting and goes so much further than beyond the first vision. Before we get too far into what Web3 will be, let's do a quick recap of the World Wide Web so far. So everything from the first connected computer networks to those read-only websites that you guys might remember from the end of the 90s, these actually all fall under Web 1. Web 1 pages were static and read-only, which was actually really great for sharing information, but not so great for interacting with other people. Think of it like Wikipedia. Web 1 was a significant technological breakthrough, and even though we compare it to the web we use now, most of the web pages look pretty plain and also pretty boring. Web 2 is the version of the web that we are all using right now. If you're watching this on YouTube, you're using Web 2. Now, what's interesting with Web 2 is web pages actually became dynamic and global two-way communications. They became so much faster. E-commerce sites like Amazon, they took off, and Google began indexing to the internet. And Facebook, they gave us this convenient place to share photos of pets and food with people who also enjoy sharing photos of pets and food. Web 2 sparked a revolution in global trade, and businesses over the world had to really adapt or be risks left behind. Yet, despite this obvious and also noteworthy achievements, Web2 has had a number of quite serious shortcomings, most of which revolve around centralized control. So since the release of the first iPhone all the way back in 2017, a handful of companies have really aggressively asserted their control over the internet. I don't even need to say their names, I'm pretty sure you've worked it out. The business model of these companies use hinges on storage and then sells our data to third parties in exchange for using their platforms for free. So to use Web2 platforms, we have to trust in centralized corporations to not misuse the data that we hand over when we use the platforms, which is always a little bit optimistic. And also, all of our data is stored together in huge centralized data exchanges, which means that the large portions of the internet rely on a single point of failure while trying not to fail. And given that Amazon's web service had a 7-hour outage very recently, it's also pretty optimistic. So although Web 2 brought a lot of positive changes to the internet, its centralized control also proved to be a big problem. So naturally, decentralizing the internet is at the heart of Web 3. While Web 2 gave the internet a front-end facelift, Web3 is more of a back-end update, happening a little bit more behind the scenes. Now, not everybody agrees on exactly what Web3 is or what it will become just yet. However, most people agree the next iteration of the internet will most likely involve decentralizing control over the internet. The idea is to end our collective reliance on these handfuls of tech giants while also reducing the amount of control they have on one company and handing over to the internet moving forward in years to come. So now that we're clear on what Web3 is, you're also now probably wondering the million-dollar question: how will Web3 disrupt our society? So as we move into Web3 and the internet becomes more and more decentralized, you won't have to have a different account for every single platform like Twitter or Amazon. Instead, tools like MetaMask and Trust Wallet will actually allow to give anyone access to decentralized applications, or what we know as dApps, from anywhere and without being required to hand over any sensitive or any personal details. So as dApps run using smart contracts rather than any human intermediaries, anyone can use them without needing approval from any companies or any government. In time, this will turn into decentralization, preventing private companies having the only say on who gets to use the internet services and under what conditions. This will also reduce this monopolistic behavior that we've been seeing for years, like companies shutting down competitor sites or also acquiring competitor sites and services. So as DeFi improves and more people start using decentralized finance, DeFi will actually become accessible to people living in developing countries who currently can't access any financial services whatsoever. This will also enable more people to access financial services without needing permissions from a bank or from any other company. So some projects like Helium are actually already trying to decentralize the actual internet and access to it by building a decentralized network of hotspots spread out all over the world. Right now, we have very little control over the data we hand over. Most of the websites that you visit, they actually pick up some information about you. They store it, they package it up, and they pass it on, and they pass it on for a profit. This is how Facebook makes 98% of its profit. But on Web3, online platforms are going to have to try much harder time tracking how we use their platforms. And selling our data to third parties will probably not be impossible, but really difficult without first obtaining our express permission. All of our data, from our Thanksgiving photos on social media to financial transactions and possibly even our entire digital identity, they'll be entirely under our control. On Web3, we'll actually be able to choose which pieces of information we choose to share and on which platforms and on a case-by-case basis. Some platforms might even offer to pay for your data in crypto, so instead of a third party getting the profit, that comes back to you. Platforms and protocols will be able to become interoperable, as will your data. And information which is available somewhere will be a lot more accessible to everyone. In practice, this will allow you to do some really cool stuff, like move all of your social media posts, statuses, and updates into one site without the need for any hassle and just with a few clicks. And this could even mean having proofs of your identity, like your passport or educational certificates, stored securely in a digital wallet, but available online whenever you need them. Machine learning involves using data and algorithms to really imitate the way that we humans interact and how we learn. There are plenty of Web2 applications like Google that already use machine learning to provide us with a better, more relevant, and often a personalized service. Yes, this is cool and we use it a lot and it is useful, but decentralized protocols will actually be able to use AI and machine learning in ways that Web2 apps, they can't. Data protection and privacy laws, they currently stop companies from accessing and analyzing incredibly useful data because it's sensitive or private, and for a good reason. But if that data was usable, it would be incredibly useful for medical research, for designing software, for self-driving cars. But decentralized Web3 applications, they can allow AI and machine learning programs to analyze private or personal data without the data owner sharing the document directly, mainly by using the blockchain. So whoever owns valuable data can actually profit from companies using it without sacrificing the ownership over the data set or the privacy of anyone's data used within that set. Exactly how this works is a little outside the scope for a 10-minute YouTube video, but you can actually check out Ocean Protocol and there is a lot more that you can learn. And keep in mind the potential of applications in AI and Web3 go way beyond the targeted advertising and personalized speech results that we enjoy today on Web2. The biggest internet companies around today are, by design, centralized and not at all democratic. This often creates a misalignment between what the shareholders of the company want, which is normally the money, and mostly what the platform and the customers want, which is better privacy, more control over their own data, and an engaging and fun experience. Let's take Facebook for example. For every big change to Facebook's platform, this is decided by Facebook's biggest shareholders. The Facebook employees have some say in what goes on in the day-to-day running of the platform, but in general, there isn't so much they can do if they don't like the overall direction the company is going in, or also if they don't morally agree with it. Their only real option is to leave and complain about Facebook and about the experience. So the decisions are made by a tiny number of Facebook shareholders that have significant effect on the lives and the livelihoods of billions of Facebook users. And those billions of users actually don't get a say in any of the decisions that Facebook makes. But let's imagine just for a moment that Facebook operated democratically and a DAO. What would that look like? If you've been in crypto for more than 5 minutes, you'll certainly already know about decentralized autonomous organizations, also known as DAOs. They turn the idea of a top-down traditional corporate structure on its head by giving anyone with one of the DAO governance tokens a say in how it operates. And although DAOs are mostly thought of as a crypto thing, they also have the potential to completely transform how businesses all over the world operate by altering how they're controlled. So if Facebook were a DAO, anyone who owned one of Facebook's DAO's tokens would actually be able to vote on every change to the platform, as well as suggest new features. And those features could include an unfiltered news feed or being able to see who's viewed your profile, even having the option to not be tracked on the platform whatsoever. And as more people join the DAO, the price of each DAO token actually rises. And this creates a financial incentive for each of the platform's users to build features which will attract the most people, having a focus on how to attract the most value from users to maximize profits. In other words, everyone does seem to benefit from the platform being equitable and also being fun. And if someone who owns a Facebook DAO token decides they don't like the direction the platform's going, they can just sell their token and move to another platform. If this all sounds a little bit far-fetched, know that decentralized social DAOs already exist, like Friends with Benefits and the Bored Ape Yacht Club. And while this is an extremely unlikely event that we could see Facebook going to become a DAO anytime soon, or ever really, Web3 will still have a decentralized social media platform controlled entirely by communities. Decentralized platforms on Web3, they don't rely on a single data center or a company to stay online. Instead, they're hosted by peer-to-peer networks spread out all over the world. There's no single point of failure in any Web3 network, which means that even a huge chunk of the network is attacked or taken offline, the platform will still stay up and running. This also means anyone can decide who gets to use which platforms or what they can say online. This is great for freedom of speech, especially for people who live in countries which are currently limited with the access of certain websites or monitor what they say and what they do online. However, censorship-proof platforms are also double-edged. So giving a voice to the unheard or the oppressed has obvious benefits, but people have also raised some really serious and some very valid concerns about the spread of illegal, anonymously posted content online. And this is a big issue because, unfortunately, a censorship-proof web means that nobody gets censored, and nobody includes the people that we really don't want to hear from. The biggest point of today is that Web3 will allow us to coordinate better than ever before and form decentralized communities across the global web. We'll be able to safely trade value and information with people that we've never met and that we wouldn't normally trust without the need for an intermediary. And from this, our societies become more efficient every time we remove a rent-seeking third party that we no longer need. We can share useful data with one another without actually sacrificing privacy, which is such an important element. We can end our reliance on centralized monopolies like Wall Street banks and also these tech giants that we've referred to in this video today. Now, one of the most important factors of all, Web3 gives us a way to trust one another and coordinate our efforts to achieve our mutual goals much easier than we can now. Yes, there will be some trade-offs, but look how far Web2 has changed our lives so far. And we can only imagine what Web3 world will actually look like. So now I want to turn to you all and ask you, what are your thoughts on Web3? Are you for or are you against? Share your thoughts with me. Personally, I am all in on the idea. That is all from me. If you do have any more questions about this wild world of crypto, you can always ask Alex in the description box below.